I am reminded of the prediction President George W. Bush made at the dedication of the 9/11 Pentagon Memorial in 2008. In that speech, he said, quote, "For future generations, this memorial will be a place of learning. The day will come when most Americans have no living memory of the events of September the 11th." End quote. It has been more than two decades since the terrorist attacks of September 11th, and in that time, the rising generation of young leaders in this country and across the world have grown up with no or very little memory of that day. Despite lacking this lived experience, these young minds come to special places, like the Pentagon Memorial and here at Flight 93 National Memorial, to learn how the actions of ordinary people have shaped their world. As I stand here this morning, the presence of thousands of students joining us virtually here across the country for the Teach to Remember 9/11, a national day of learning, confirms the prediction President Bush made in 2008. Today, we welcome this generation to join us in honoring the 40 passengers and crew members of the Flight 93 and their courageous actions. Good morning. My name is Stephen Clark, Superintendent of the National Parks of Western Pennsylvania, which includes this special place. On behalf of the National Park Service, I welcome all of you to Flight 93 National Memorial. I'd like to take a moment and recognize and thank the sailors from the USS Somerset who traveled from San Diego, California to take and enjoy and embrace this memorial on this special day. I'd also like to take a moment to thank all members of our armed forces currently serving and those who have served and their families for their dedication to our great nation. I'd like to also welcome National Park Service Director Sams and all of our elected officials. Also in the audience today is John Hamilton. John is currently a commercial pilot, a veteran, and co-founder and chairman of the board of the 957 Project, whose specific mission it is to connect veterans with young people in order to perpetuate courage, resilience, service, teamwork, and the legacy of Flight 93. I want to extend a special welcome to the young generation and their teachers who are joining us virtually across the country as part of the memorial's second year of the National Day of Learning. As a matter of fact, as I understand it, currently there are more than 20,000 students from 316 schools from more than 29 states with us at this very moment across the country and at this memorial. This virtual education program designed to bring this special ceremony and the on-site experience of the memorial to the classroom would not be possible without the Friends of Flight 93. We extend our sincerest thank you to the leaders and members of this wonderful organization who help preserve and share this remarkable place with people across the world. Further, we thank you for your opportunity to bring the story of Flight 93 and September 11th to our classrooms. We are honored today by the presence of many families and friends of the passengers and crew members of Flight 93. We thank you for joining us here today, in person, and virtually all over the world. We are forever grateful for your ongoing efforts in supporting the National Park Service, its partners, and your willingness to share your loved ones with us. Your participation in today's moment of remembrance allows us to keep our promise to never forget the 2,977 innocent lives lost in the largest international terrorist attack on American soil. We come here to remember them and to commemorate the actions of 40 of those people whose collective efforts that morning saved countless lives. At this time, 23 years ago, the 40 passengers and crew members of Flight 93 made a decision that would change our world forever. Their decision to fight back against the terrorists who had hijacked their plane demonstrates the power of individuals to come together in a time of crisis to make a monumental difference. The 7 crew members and 33 passengers fought as one on that morning, preventing Flight 93 from reaching the United States Capitol, saving an untold number of people and saving the center of our democracy. We honor their actions as a truly heroic display of unity, courage, and defiance in the face of tremendous adversity. We remember them and the nearly 3,000 individuals lost at the Trade Center and the Pentagon that day. As we reflect back 23 years ago this morning, let us begin this moment with the Pledge of Allegiance. Please rise as you are able and join us in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance. Leading the pledge this morning is Flight 93 volunteer Ambassador Paul Donati.
Please join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Thank you, Paul, for leading today's pledge and for your 7 years of outstanding dedicated service to our memorial. I would also like to thank all of the Flight 93 volunteer ambassadors, past and present, for their unwavering commitment to assisting us in fulfilling our mission. I'd also like to recognize our amazing and dedicated AmeriCorps volunteers, led by Cindy Small, who assists us each and every year on this special day. We are fortunate to be joined this morning by both active and former members of the first responder community. At the conclusion of our observance, members of the Pennsylvania State Police Honor Guard will open the ceremonial gate, providing a salute for family members as they enter the sacred ground. Pennsylvania State Police troopers served as some of the first responders to the crash of Flight 93, and over the subsequent 13 days of investigation that followed, troopers from across the state served as sentinels guarding the site around the clock. Along with their counterparts who responded to the World Trade Center in New York and the Pentagon in Arlington, Virginia, the Pennsylvania State Police represent the very best of our nation. We thank them for their resolute courage and dedication to others as we remember the 441 first responders who gave their lives in an effort to save thousands that morning. I encourage you all to continue this gratitude by taking a moment to recognize or thank a member from your response community for their generous service. Because thanking a first responder in your community is one of the many ways we can continue to ensure that the 40 heroes whose names are inscribed on this marble wall are never forgotten, and that this new generation and those that follow can learn from their inspiring story. This transformation of this hallowed ground from a reclaimed coal strip mine to a vibrant 2,200-acre world-class memorial and learning space is another vital example of how we continue to honor their legacy. However, the National Park Service is not alone in our efforts to preserve the legacy of the 40 passengers and crew members. Citizens right here in Somerset County and adjacent to this special place have developed their own unique ways to remember the 40 heroes and the impact they have had on our world. Patriot Park honors 7,067 American service members who gave their lives in a global war on terror, and the Remember Me Rose Garden, a beautiful living tribute to the passengers and crew of Flight 93. Further, our efforts to honor America's heroes. As well this year, through the collaboration with the September 11th National Memorial Trail Alliance, we completed alignments through three of the national park units in western Pennsylvania, connecting them to the 1,500-mile 9/11 National Memorial Trail, which ultimately connects all three of the September 11th attack sites in an unbroken chain. We all thank these organizations for their efforts in developing new ways to pay tribute to those lost in the terrorist attacks on September 11th and to ensure their legacy is carried on to the next generation. Though these major elements of this memorial are complete, our work here is far from over. It is our duty to preserve this special place as both a memorial and a classroom for our children. It is our hope that by honoring the passengers and crew members here today, future generations may act with the same courage and determination to face their own challenges. Helping to honor the 40 passengers and crew members today is Matthew LeBlanc, a flight attendant for Southwest Airlines and longtime flight attendant for Southwest and also a volunteer ambassador. Mr. LeBlanc will lead the reading of their names, joined by family members who have made their journey here to read the names of their loved ones. Joining Matt and family members this morning is Friends of Flight 93 President Fred Lukaczynski and Executive Director Donna Gibson. As the leaders of our partner organization, Fred and Donna provide us with invaluable support. As I mentioned earlier, the Friends of Flight 93 National Memorial have been instrumental in much of our work here, from assisting with reforestation and landscape improvements to providing educational scholarships to students visiting the memorial. The Friends have supported many, many of our endeavors with volunteers, resources, and civic engagement. Their support for our current educational initiatives, including assisting with creating and distributing virtual teaching materials, helps us ensure that children worldwide have access to this powerful place and its inspiring story. We extend our sincerest thank you to Fred and Donna for your dedication to honoring the passengers and crew members of Flight 93 today and every day. After each name is read this morning, Fred and Donna will ring the bells of remembrance in memory of the 40 passengers and crew members of Flight 93. Concluding our moment of remembrance by offering an interfaith mediation of closure, healing, and peace will be Reverend Dan Lawrence. Reverend Lawrence is a Pennsylvania State Police chaplain who also serves as the lead pastor at Murraysville Alliance Church and also the police, fire, and emergency services chaplain for the municipality of Murraysville, Pennsylvania. I invite the family seated here afterwards to join the sacred ground for a private wreath laying at the site. Before we conclude here today, I think it only appropriate to again recognize all of our volunteers, partners, as well as National Park Service staff, whose commitment and unwavering dedication to this special place is so profoundly appreciated. And finally, to the families, both here and attending virtually, it is truly our honor and privilege to tell the story of your loved ones today, tomorrow, and for generations to come. We hope that this moment of remembrance and the work we all do here at this sacred ground will allow us to continue to pass on the story of the 40 heroes aboard Flight 93, and with it, a message of hope, unity, love, and courage for our future.
Christian Adams.
Sister Georgine Rose Cork and Marisay.
James. Dyslexia. Jeremy Logan Glick. Kristen Osterholm White Gold.
Katuzi Grandcolas, and unborn child.
My sister, Wanda Anita Green.
Richard J. Guadagno.
My uncle, First Officer Leroy Homer.
My son, Toshiya Kuge.
My mom, Cece Louise Ross Lyles.
Hilda Marson.
Louis Joey Aggie the second.
Donald Arthur Peterson. David Rothenberg.
Christine Ann Sider. Shortly after the Flight 93 crash site was open to the public, I was part of an organized motorcycle ride to arrive here and pay our respects to the passengers and crew of those who heroically gave their lives to save the lives of others. There was a dirt road that went past a scrap pile up here on the hill, metal, and I asked Ranger Schaefer where was the bales of hay and the chain link fence for the memorial, and he told me right up here on the hill. And I remember arriving there, and it was a overcast day, somewhat cool and windy. As I stood at the temporary memorial up on the hill, I looked out to the crash site, and I contemplated all what may have happened and some of the decisions that were made based upon some of the information we were receiving that they made that day to stop an act of terrorism. I contemplated the fact that they no doubt knew that they would not be going home. It was their final flight. As I overlooked the crash site, I asked myself that if I were on that plane, knowing what they knew and the decisions that they were making, what would I do? What would be some actions that I would take that day? And it quickly came to my mind in an overwhelming way that on any given day, I could personally take my last flight. In the motorcycle community, we call it our last ride. It doesn't have to be due to a tragic event. It could be a result of natural causes. But that day will come. So, what would I do? Well, the first thing that I would do is make sure that everything was right between me and my God. I would make peace with Him because I would ask Him for forgiveness of all my transgressions against Him, and I would leave no stone unturned because I knew, I would know that soon I would be given an account to Him. I then would thank Him for my many blessings and the life that was given to me. And sometimes we're not quick to do that, are we? I would ask Him to watch over my wife and family, keep an eye on them until that day I see Him again. The second thing I would do is I would want to make sure that my wife and children knew that I love them. Life can get so complicated and busy, and you know, we often choose to fight on mountains that, in the overall scheme of things, they're only molehills. We're told, God tells us to not let the sun set on our anger and to reconcile with kindness, grace, and forgiveness.
Life is too short. Life is too short. So don't let a day go by without saying, I love you to your family. And a hug and a kiss can go a long way. And I don't have this in my notes now. Depending on what my wife and I are going through, sometimes the kisses are sweeter some days than others. But I make sure that I tell her I love her. Because, see, on any given day, right? Lastly, I would hope to have shown kindness and compassion, and doing what is good and right for others. The character of the passengers and crew showed who they were that day by putting others first. Their individual and corporate actions on that day saved many innocent, unsuspecting lives from tragedy. Today, there are individuals here from all professions, all walks of life, families, and backgrounds. But the one thing that we all have in common is this: we're part of humanity. If we don't purposely choose to serve for the good of others, self-centeredness can overtake our lives and we can go through life without making a difference for the good of others. We are asked to love our neighbors as ourselves. There are those that need a kind word. They need a gentle touch and an act of kindness. They need a demonstration of grace, forgiveness, and respect. Serving others and doing what is right and good for those around us will cost us something. It may be our own life someday. Today is a reminder of that. As I left the memorial and crash site that day, before I got on my motorcycle to ride away, I renewed my relationship with God. When I got home, I told my family how much I loved them, and a hug and kiss were in order. And I have sought to do what is right and tried to serve and do good for others. So once again, as I stand here with all of you today at this Flight 93 Memorial, overlooking the crash site, I'm reminded of those things. I put before you today as a meditation and a challenge to do the same. Today is the day. Tomorrow may never come. And that's my challenge for you. If you wouldn't mind, please stand as I have a closing prayer for us. And then at the conclusion of my prayer, I was going to recite the Lord's Prayer, and if you know it, please join me. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this memorial that has been built and dedicated to remember the passengers and crew of Flight 93. Thank you for all those who have worked so hard and tirelessly to make this day of remembrance and this memorial possible. May we not forget the lives lost and the heroism that defined 9/11/2001. Lord, to this day, those who were dramatically affected by the tragedies of that day still need your healing hand. The loss is still very real. The physical, emotional, and spiritual scars remain. The consequences of that day are long-standing. Please continue to extend your grace and hope to them. Please give safe travels to all who return home today. As we return home, may we not forget being with each other. Hear our prayers, know our hearts, and may your blessings be upon us. Thank you for this great country in which we live, the United States of America. Watch over those who serve and protect it at home and abroad. In God we trust. In God, bless America. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Amen. Amen.